Alright, hello. I'd like to spend the next few videos talking about the wave equation. So, we saw the wave equation already in the second video, and in that video I made a small simplification. I said that the wave equation was UTT equals UXX. So I left out this C squared here that you would usually see in the wave equation when you see it in a textbook. And so we're going to put that back in there. So we're going to put a C squared in front of the UXX. So this C squared is a constant, and so really you have a whole family of wave equations, one for every choice of value of C. Now it may look a little funny at first, the fact that this is a C squared rather than just, say, a C. And there's a couple reasons for that. First reason is you can think of it as a reminder that this constant in front of UXX needs to be positive. If I were to take something like UTT equals minus UXX, that would be a much different kind of equation. It would have different kinds of solutions, and there'd really be I would not be able to call it the wave equation. The other reason that I take C squared is that C itself is a quantity of interest. It's called the wave speed, and we'll see there's a very easy explanation why I would call it the wave speed. We'll see that in a little while. So let's start with some intuition. And let's suppose that you and I are playing with a string. And here you are holding onto one end of the string, and here I am over here holding onto the other end of the string. And we stretch the string out tightly between the two of us. So there it is, stretched out tight. Now we play a game, wiggle the string, and so you give the end of the string a wiggle, and we get this wiggle going down the string, so this wave going down the string. Okay, so now let's connect this game that we're playing with the variables we have here. Let's call the displacement of the string from its equilibrium, the vertical displacement of the string, let's call that the variable u. So this is u, and it's u of xt. Now, t is a measurement of time, of course, so this is all in motion. And x, we'll just think of it as a measurement of the position along the string horizontally. So you could start off x as being 0 here and measure it positive to the right, for instance. Okay, so now let's zoom in on this wiggle thing that we've got going on here. Let's zoom in and let's see if we can reason a little bit about it and have the wave equation kind of come out of that reasoning. Okay, so here we are zoomed in on the wiggly part of the string. I'll do my best to draw a wiggle here. All right, not bad. And I'll draw the equilibrium line in here somewhere. It doesn't matter exactly where. How about right there? All right, so let's look first at what are essentially the easiest parts of this picture to understand. Let's look at the peak right here and the valley right there. Okay, so what's happening to this little piece of string at the peak of this mountain? Well, the string around the top of that mountain, that's curved downward. And so the tension will be pulling this point at the very peak downward. So there's a downward force, and I'll show that with just by drawing an arrow there. So there's downward force acting on that little piece of string right there. Similarly, over here at the bottom of this valley, the string around that little piece where the yellow dot is, that string is curved upward, and so it's exerting an upward force there. The tension of the string is pulling it up. So I'll draw that arrow there. Now nearby these points, I will have similar forces, but they'll be smaller in magnitude. And that's simply because the string is not quite as curved. As I move away from the peak of the mountain or the very bottom of the valley, I have a little less curvature to the string. So I have still upward forces. At some point, the downward forces and the upward forces have to meet. And where they meet in the middle, there will be zero force. Okay, so there's no force, no up or down force acting at that point. All right, well, what are we saying here, really? Well, we're making an assertion about the relationship between the concavity of this string, thinking of this string as a graph of a function of x, the concavity of that graph, and the forces acting on the string. So let's make a leap of faith here, and let's say that the force is proportional to the concavity. It's clearly related to the concavity. The greater the concavity, the greater the force. And let's make that leap of faith and say that it's proportional. So force is proportional to the concavity of the string. So this is essentially a reasonable conclusion from this picture that we've drawn. Now let's take it one step further and let's look at what we mean by concavity. Well, what's concavity? Concavity is the second derivative of this graph as a function of x. So it's simply uxx. And why is it the partial derivative? Well, we're looking at a fixed point in time. So t is fixed, and we're taking the derivative with respect to x twice to get the concavity of this graph. Now, what's force? Well, force is mass times acceleration by Newton's second law. So F is equal to ma. And Newton's second law you think of as being something that you would use on, a particle. And so what we can do is we can think of each little point on this string as being some a particle with some fixed mass. Say it's a nice uniform density. So let's not worry about what the mass is. So we're talking about the acceleration of a little fixed point on this string, thinking of it like a particle. Well, what would that be in terms of the displacement? Well, the acceleration in terms of the displacement is simply the second derivative with respect to time. So this is m times utt. I'm fixing x and I'm looking at the way that the little piece of string is moving up and down, thinking of it like it's a little particle. And so what can we conclude from all this? Well, we know that force is proportional to UTT. It's M times UTT. Concavity, on the other hand, is simply UXX. So the big conclusion here is that UTT is proportional to UXX. And I'll write the proportionality constant as simply k. UTT equals k times uxx. What's the sine of k? Well, if I'm concave down, then my acceleration is downward. If I'm concave up, my acceleration is upward. So k is a positive constant. K is positive. Therefore, I could, if I wanted to, write it as a square. So I could say something like k equals c squared. Okay, so we've finished our slick little argument, and here we are staring at the wave equation. Now, there's a lot of things that are sort of wrong with this argument. It's what I'd call a fast and loose. And see if you can just reflect on it and think about all the assumptions that are lurking in here. I'll give you a couple. Well, one thing is we assumed very clearly that force is proportional to concavity. There's no reason a priori that it should be a proportionality. Maybe there's some other sort of functional relationship that looks like this. Another assumption that we made is that the motion is straight up and down vertical, right? Maybe there's some side-to-side motion going on here. Things might get much more complicated. All right, so there's lots of problems, but anyway, you can get some intuition from this. Now, let me conclude with a little nugget of information about C. And so what I'm going to do is just a quick dimensional analysis. And this is something you usually learn in physics classes, but it's also useful in math classes. What are the dimensions of UTT? Well, the dimensions of U are length. It's a displacement, so it's length. The second derivative with respect to time, the dimensions of UTT are length over time squared. So the UTT has dimensions length over time squared. On the other hand, UXX, that's length over length squared. So that's simply 1 over length. Dimensions are 1 over length, or length inverse, I guess. So what does that mean, the dimensions of C squared are? Well, that implies then that in order for the dimensionality of UTT to be equal to the dimensionality of C squared UXX, I must have the dimensions of C squared be length squared divided by time squared. Well, that means that C has dimensions length over time. That's a velocity. Okay, so it's reasonable to expect that C, in a physical problem, C should be some kind of velocity.